So on this episode of The Future of Eye Care, I had the opportunity to sit down with Alberto Gonzales, neuro-ophthalmologist and CEO of All Eyes. So welcome to the show, Alberto.
Thank you very much, Bob.
Hey, so for people who don't know you, if you'd share a little bit about your background, where you grew up, where you went to medical school, and where you practice ophthalmology.
Watch, that will be a story. Well, I grew up in Havana, Cuba. I did my medical school, residency of family medicine, and residency in ophthalmology in Cuba, in the University of Havana. Then I did a fellowship in neuro-ophthalmology in the Institute of Neurology and Neurosurgery, also in Havana. Then I came to the U.S., and did a research fellowship with Dr. Weinreb and Hamilton Glaucoma Center. Amazing experience, learned a lot. Then I had to go back to Cuba for personal reasons. And in 2010, decided to come back. And this time, forever. So I've been, since then, I've been working in the industry. I find this field very fascinating, doing every day something new, developing new product and helping people that way. It's really kind of very good for us.
Sure. Yeah. So, we spent some time together. We launched a company together about 10 years ago where you joined as the medical director of Diopsis back then. So it must have been a pretty big departure from how you were practicing medicine in Cuba to coming and seeing how business was operated here in the U.S. And any pearls you want to kind of share with your experience from that?
Sure. It's a complete different system, right? Of course, Cuba is socialist. Medicine is socialist. But it has its own peculiarity, some... they lack a lot of, of products, medicine, and technical, I would say, component of the health system. And what they basically do is they fulfill all of that lack of technical support with human support. So basically the Cuban health system it's founded over the human work rather than technical work. So they, every year, that's, hundreds and hundreds of doctors being graduated. And then unfortunately they use it for other purposes, but that's not the goal of this conversation. The system here is, of course, completely different. There's a lot of technical advantages. We are the best country in the world. And I've been lucky to working with the best doctors in the eye care in this country. I've been lucky to doing research with them and developing new product with you, Bob, and distributing all over the country and the world.
Sure. So I was going to ask you one of my favorite, just the last question on this topic, because I remember a story you told me, and you hear doctors here complain about, the vision care reimbursements and the billing reimbursements. But one of my favorite stories from you is when you used to share some of the forms of payment you used to get from some of your patients under that other system. You mind sharing some of those forms of payments with people just so they can understand?
But reimbursement is decreasing. I said, well, if you have to get a car, get, like a glass of gas, bring it to your office, and then fill it up with bananas, pigs, and chickens, and then that's how you get paid. Then you're not going to complain too much about
Livestock and produce, not necessarily the same type of reimbursement as we got here, right? it's a tremendous story, Alberto, from where you came from. I find it so inspiring. And that's why I wanted to have you on the call, because now you've gone from medical director of one startup to, you're the CEO of a new company, a new startup, new technology. Would you mind sharing, number one, what are you doing now, so everyone knows? And then I want to talk about, how did you come up with the idea?
So first of all, I have to say that I'm very grateful for all of these 10 years that I spent working with amazing people. And I learned a lot, what should be done, what not should be done. And that helped me a lot to gain in knowledge and networking enough, at least enough to start this new venture. We looked around, and when I sort of evaluated the current conditions, basically we have a huge demand of eye care, but unfortunately we do not have a comprehensive or at least fully available eye care for everybody. So the way basically the government is solving this issue is because the highly educated personnel, is the graduation of these doctors are not increasing. But on the other hand, the demand is significantly increasing. So the way basically the government is solving this issue is increasing the graduation of, ancillary personnel, people, technical personnel that can fill in the gap. That's number one. And second, the technology. And then we decided, okay, if we want to be part of the future and if we want to be part of the solution, then definitely we have to be on the technology side of it. The next step is, okay, now that we're going to be, we want to be part of the solution, the next step is, how can we do it? How can we build something that can improve the accessibility, comfortability, and efficient delivery way to provide eye care? And basically, we looked around, we started using first doing software applications. We soon find out that would never be the standard of care. And then we understood that we needed to come up with a standardized method of evaluation of patients. And that's how we came up with virtual reality, which, by the way, we were not the first to do this. The first virtual reality for eye care was patented in late 80. I think it was 88, 89. And unfortunately at that point, those inventors, there was no enough development of virtual reality technology at that point. They were very advanced for their time. And they never saw the light, of the in the market. In this situation, 2019, 2020, the development of virtual reality, in general, let's call it mixed reality, it's growing exponentially, and it's allowing us to use it as a standard hardware platform for the evaluation of this patient. And that's basically the story.
That's great. So the name of the company, the name of the product that you're delivering?
The name of the company is All Eyes. That's a funny story. We wanted to start with ALL Eyes in order to, be able to, take care of all the eyes in the entire world. But unfortunately, the domain was taken. So we said, how can we sound something similar? So we changed the O by the A, and then we convert into O Lights instead of all lights, right? So a very simple story on that. We developed our first model, which is called Visuall, with double L at the end. Again, all the purpose is trying to bring eye care to everybody. And the Visuall is basically a platform that it is divided in three main components: the cloud, the web app, and the headset. The cloud, everything happens, storage, analytics, all the algorithms runs on the cloud. The web app is the tool that the doctor uses to prescribe the test, to evaluate the reports, printing, send it to EMR, et cetera. And the headset is the part that the patient interacts with. And on that visual, we have two models. We have the Visuall S, which is the standard model for in-office use. And the goal with this model is to improve the efficiency of the doctor. The platform includes several psychophysical tests, like perimetry, different protocols of perimetry, visual acuity, several protocols of visual acuity, and we partner with one of the color diagnostic to come up with very quickly with a solution for color testing. We have, it's amazing and endless, the capabilities of this platform. We, for you to have an idea, we plan to release about 2 modules every 6 months approximately. If we keep this trend of release, we have a pipeline for 6 years, and it will grow even more than that. So I don't think we'll ever stop innovating and developing new products.
That's great. So with the headset modality, you can add on a lot of modules without increasing the footprint. So there's definitely a benefit for these offices. We've seen limited space whenever we're launching new technology. In terms of business model, I would imagine then there's probably an upfront purchase opportunity, but also probably a subscription model with all those increased modules. What type of business model do you have planned?
The business is a mixed model. We have a capital equipment, so the doctor acquires the device, which by the way has a lot of incentive, ADA, tax credit. It has other incentive that minimizes the burden, even that the price is very, very significantly low compared with the standard perimetries and another platform. Not even taking into account that it's a multi-testing platform. So the value is relatively very low compared to that. That is the main model, the capital equipment, but then we have a optional subscription model, or what we call also membership, that not only has a lot of advantages for keeping the good relationship and keeping the updated the system, but also includes a protection plan that if there is a physical damage to the device, we can take care of it without needing any kind of technical assistant. So we don't require, the doctor doesn't need to wait for a technician to come in and fix the device. No, there's a problem, they connect to us either via text or phone call, and we remotely access the platform, we evaluate it, and if there is no solution remotely, we ship a new one overnight. Because the main value proposition of OLIS is efficiency. That's the main value proposition for us.
That's great. So in terms of being a new CEO, then you've been at this over the past couple of years you were working on this, but you kind of went full-time into this past year?
Right. 2020, I started full-time working for OLIS. I've been blessed with a team that works very united. It was very interesting because we always were a virtual company. We have, our CTO is in Philadelphia. The CEO and COO are in New Jersey. The vice president of sales in Florida. So we are a virtual organization. When the COVID arrived and disrupted so many companies, it actually didn't change anything for us.
That's great.
we were ready for that. And I think that's one of the reasons we have been successful, is because we were ready for already for these conditions that we're currently going through. And all those new measurements that Google's and Amazon are trying to implement to have workers, you know, working from home, we did that before them. So we are, that helped a lot.
So any challenges that you've faced as a new CEO, where in the past, you know, you didn't have to wear that hat, right? You were, as a medical director, you just got to deal with the clinical, but being CEO is a whole different ball game. So what challenges have you experienced, lessons you've learned that you'd like to share with anyone starting their own business?
So when I started looking in, when this idea of being an entrepreneur came into my head, I started looking into information, right? And this is one of the beauty of this country. The information is on the palm of your hand. If you want to do something, you just have to click and you get tons of information. Not only information, but actually people, very good people that are willing to help you for nothing, just for the sake of being helpful to someone else, which, by the way, is what we're trying to do also. So I started looking for that. And one thing that I learned early on is that you must really like what you are about to do, because 80% of the time it's fixing issues, it's fixing problems. And then you have 20% of the time with good news and enjoying the results of your work. But most of the time it's work. So what you said is true, it's very challenging, but if you love it like we do, I mean, I wake up every day and there is no difference between weekdays and weekends. I'm blessed to have a beautiful family that support me, and that's also very important to be successful on your career.
Sure. Well, I know, you know, starting something new myself, I think my wife and kid feel the same way, that there's no difference between the weekdays and weekends when I'm like, I'm gonna go outside and do work a little bit on the laptop. So I'm sure but the family's doing well, and your wife, and you have a new family member, I think, since the last time I spoke to you, or I'm not sure.
Yeah, I have two boys. I had a girl in Havana while I was in Havana. She is 23 year old, my princess. But then I moved to US, and I had two boys. One is 6, the other is 4. Those are pirates. They're killing me, but I love them.
Sure, I can definitely relate to that. So, you know,
I have gone through a lot of, you know, roads, and you are now in this new venture director. So congratulations on your, you know, new position. You should be going also through a lot of changes in your life, right?
Sure. Well, this is one of them too. You talked about people sharing their information freely. You know, I've been following some people on marketing and in how to do, you know, paid social, SEO optimization, things like that for driving inbound marketing traffic. And, you know, so I look forward to the possible collaboration between our two companies as well, where we're already integrating with your technology so we can deliver that. Something I wanted to ask you about was the home health monitoring too. That's a whole other concept. That's a whole other portion of your business that that doctors can take advantage of. There's some sort of, you mind sharing about that opportunity for doctors?
That's correct. That is the second model that we developed, which is the model H, which connects to the whole platform, and you can add unlimited amount of visual H to the mothership, which is, you know, the visual S. The home model is also not a new story. Actually, it goes far from even prehistory, but very, very early in the development of medicine. Medicine have gone through different ways, right? The initial model actually was the home model. Then the hospice or nosocomium or hospital, whatever you want to call it, came up, and then it gaining popularity, and then we started moving patients to institutions. And in the last, then we have, of course, the medicine experience base, right? Then we jump into evidence-based medicine. And now we are jumping into a mix of evidence and personalized medicine, which is something that we're very focused on. It's part of the home model that you are mentioning. The goal is to build a model that looked not as not that look at the individual, not as part of a group of people, but as an individual itself. So how do you change, how your vision change compared to yourself? When you are doing a comparison with a group of healthy, which is the, I would say the standard currently of approaching a probabilistic model, you basically are trying to fit you into, you know, into a group of people. And it's a good model, but has a limitation. The limitation is that it is a probabilistic model. It is basically trying to establish your condition compared to what is expected based on a group of healthy individuals. But there's so much variability, right? Human is so diverse, and that's part of the medicine is not an exception. So the personalization of the medicine is nothing but that, trying to diminish the influence of the interpersonal variability, and with that increase the quality of care. So the home model is basically, going back to your question after this so long preamble, sorry about that. the home model is basically in our opinion, is the only way that we can solve the current problems we have with the healthcare in USA. If we bring, at least in the beginning, the diagnostic process into your home, we are going to be fixing, it's a long list of problems that an in-office care produce. Just to start with a very, very interesting number. The time, the productivity lost just by the concept of a patient driving to the office and waiting in the waiting room till the doctor can, you know, see them, it's calculated in 52 billion every year in the United States. It's amazing the amount of money that we're losing just by the concept of driving back and forth and being seated in that waiting room. So that's one problem that we're gonna solve, right, with the home model. The second problem is accessibility. We have patients, especially in rural areas, where they have to drive sometimes hours to see their doctors. There is also the problem of the white coat syndrome, right? When you go to an office and you start getting tests, you want to win, right? We're human. We all human want to win, right? So we want to be good. And that's what we try to do when we are tested, we're being tested. We're trying to see better. We're trying to do more than we can actually do. Or the other part is that we are so stressful that the quality of our responses are low. So that's something we're gonna solve, because now the patient can take the test at any time. It can take as long as they want, because there's no limitation, right? And you are way more comfortable and no stressed at all. So that's one of the good aspects also of the home care. And one very important, Bob, it's the amount of data that you can collect. We already know based on research performed that the greater the amount, like let's talk specific about visual field tests. The greater the amount of data you have, the greater the amount of tests that you can get in a given period of time, the earlier you can detect progression. And the only way we can do this actually different or better in terms of frequency is at home. That's it, period. Imagine now most of patients get one or two visual fields. I'm talking about glaucoma patient. I'm not talking not even about, you know, a regular patient. One or twice a year. In fact, there are two codes that are the ones that are most underserved, underutilized in the US healthcare. One is perimetry and the second one is gonioscopy. For some reason, the average visual field test that a doctor perform every year is 256 tests. That's very little. And not counting that most of those tests, the quality is, you know, very bad. So that's something that we can help solving with a home model also. The many other advantages, but I think those are probably the most important. And I think right now, Bob, we have the ideal conditions to implement this product. First, we have the technology to do it. Second, we have the necessity and a community, doctors especially, sensitized, right, with that model. And third, very important, we have a reimbursement system to support the utilization of the home monitoring of physiologic parameters. All this, which at the end should be the goal, right? All these advantages that I mentioned to you end up in something. A much better quality of care, less disability, and lower cost for the system. So it's a win-win for everybody. And that's why we're very, very, very interested in pushing forward this program.
Sure. So the convenience, speed of access you talked about, I think the other condition with that COVID's brought in are our patients are comfortable doing these more, you know, remote testing and you know, they're used to, even older patients are used to using, you know, cell phones, smartphones. So putting on a virtual headset for home monitoring of, you know, various conditions, whether it's glaucoma and or other modalities in the future as you release more modules. Yeah, I think you're definitely on to an aspect of the future of eye care for sure, which is, it's why I wanted to have you on the show and talk about it. I guess kind of, you know, in synopsis, you set it up in the beginning, you said it's all about efficiency with your company. It's kind of your core value. In terms of what's going on kind of else in the future, you're connected to a lot of people in the industry. And I was just curious, you know, is there anything else you see on the horizon? You've posted a little bit about telehealth, which, you know, that's the sector I'm in. I've seen you post something on LinkedIn saying that you think that's it. And All Eyes is tied into that as well, with the Visuall from All Eyes and the home monitoring is definitely a form of telehealth, remote technology. Just curious if there's anything else you see kind of on the horizon, you know, and it could be anything within eye care. Have you seen or heard anything else kind of cool going on out there that you're keeping your eyes on?
Well, I think in addition to the telehealth increase in the increase in utilization of healthcare, the artificial intelligence, you know, applications that they're already there. It's not that we're not talking about the future. I mean, most of the things that surround us are already driven by AI, your phone, your TV, your our technology. So many, many aspects of our life are already social media, et cetera. Unfortunately, not for good, but they're AI driven. So, and AI is gonna keep getting more and more and more inclined, which is something that, not scary, but we should be very careful, right? How we implement all this system, because it can, I'm not really worried about all this issue related to whether it's gonna be another industrial revolution. That's not gonna happen. We I think we have gained in knowledge to learn. We just need a good leaders to bring us there. That's it.
Sure. So, you know, Alberto, the reason I had you on the show, I think you've definitely illustrated, you're definitely one of the smartest doctors I've ever come across.
Oh. And, please.
You know, we've worked many shows together where you could take a doctor who came up with their hair on fire, upset about what we were doing or introducing to the market, and by the time they left, they were shaking your hand and thanking you, because the other component of it is you're definitely one of the nicest people in eye care. So always a pleasure to catch up with you. I certainly appreciate you having you on the inaugural episode, the first episode of The Future of Eye Care. I think what you're on is I think you're going to have a huge success. I look forward to working with you and integrating with your technology as we deliver it to our customers as well. We already have a couple mutual customers that use our teleoptometry service in office, as well as your virtual field testing and other modalities. So it's an exciting time to see what you're doing and to possibly be working more with you in the future.
Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you very much for your time and for let us, you know, have this little space on your program, which is awesome.
Sure. Appreciate it. And we'll talk soon. Thanks so much, Alberto.
Thank you.